Hello, Abba.
How you guys doing?
I'm doing okay.
Doing okay?
Absolutely beautiful.
A little bit of an echo there.
Oh, big echo.
Oh, see, it's always when I turn you down, I turn it back up. Is that better?
What?
Yeah, well, yeah, that's better.
Yeah, no more technical difficulties.
Okay. I'm sorry I ruined the immersion. I'm sorry. See, I was trying to make it go.
Immersion hype.
Immersion hype was ruined. So we got nothing really to talk about this week.
Nothing.
Figure we'll just
nothing.
Go.
Nothing.
We'll
pretty dry week this week.
We'll just go vapid. What do you think?
Yeah. Complete. I have no idea. I don't. Like, was there anything that you guys saw? I
mean,
I
just. No.
Oh, The Martian came out.
Oh, The Martian.
Martian's pretty cool. Yeah.
And I think the new movie Pan's coming out too.
The Moonbase Alpha 2 is started its Kickstarter.
Nice.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Did all you? Right.
That's about it. Thanks for joining us,
yeah.
Guys.
Better guys.
No. Pretty good.
All right. Yeah. There's that whole CitizenCon thing. Right.
Oh yeah. I heard about that.
God.
Huh.
My pants are still wet from that damn show, y'all.
I know.
Here's my lotion. You see, my lotion's by my desk, so you guys know what happened over here.
We had to like play that intro twice.
Desk pound. You got to do the desk pound.
Woo!
Desk pound.
Man.
Okay, so let's just talk about the intro real quick. Squadron 42 looks amazing, pants.
That's the level that they're going for, and it even showed in the initial stuff that they did too.
It's like, scary how good it is.
God, that is face melting.
It was
like my computer is going to explode. I could build the best computer in the universe. It's going to explode when it comes to this.
Well, guys, you know the $90 million is obviously not going to our game. I couldn't see it.
Private islands.
It's going to mansions and Porsches. I mean, those nice technology going on in that game. It wasn't from our money. I don't know where it came from. Fairy dust, maybe. I don't know.
It was all fake.
Space Jesus
willed it upon them.
There you go.
Yeah, they're going to break. They're going to get $100 million after this, I think. I mean, there's people that I know that were. I just watched that part of it, and we're like, oh, my God.
It looks like a AAA title. I mean,
it
like,
is
watch...
a AAA title. But, yes.
I know, but
it's like, it.
I'm sorry, yeah, quadruple A.
Yeah.
You hear that, oh, we're going for AAA title, and you're like, yeah, that's great. That's yeah, you're sure. Uh-huh. And then you see it, and it's like, this is on the level of fidelity for, like, a Halo cutscene
That game Until Dawn, which I just got through playing, looked like that, and I was like, oh my God, best looking game ever. This
or,
is going
like
to beat that.
Battlefront. I was playing a little bit of the Battlefront beta, and like
good.
The graphics fidelity and like the explosions and everything like that. It was like,
good.
And the sound effects on Battlefront.
They're really good, yeah. What are you doing, Clifford? Say, hey. Are you fapping again, Clifford?
No, I was going to get something real quick if you can give me just one second.
Yeah, you can hop up. Go ahead. We'll get started talking about something.
All right.
Before we get going, we got nothing
to talk about. Go ahead.
Before we get going, on the screen on the side over here, I'm showing Sandy doing a speech. And now I was in a meeting, and I could not get out of that meeting until like 15 minutes after the thing started. So why don't everybody, you guys go ahead and talk about this. I'll just keep shut, and then you can tell me what's going on.
I got one thing to say.
Yeah.
This close to shedding a man tear. That was the most emotional, and it was very heartfelt. It wasn't acting. Because I'll be the first to say, Sandy's not a good actress.
No. But she's a professional actress. What do you say that?
Oh, I'm just saying. No.
We love you, Sandy.
My thoughts. Yeah, I love Sandy to death. Mm-hmm. That was 100% pure, true emotion. It was beautiful.
Y'all know I love Sandy. I would have took off more for Sandy. Y'all are lucky my son was disturbing me because I had a lot more exposing to do. But my son really saved y'all. So thank Gio Jr. for interrupting me in that video.
No, but honestly, when it started, I think everyone thought that this was a resignation speech.
Yep.
I thought it was.
Yeah, and that's what I did too. And my first thought was, oh, fuck. You know, like, God damn it. And then she finished it, and there's no, like, just kind of moved on. Like, here's Chris. It's like,
wow. Pure emotion.
Just and wife confirmed.
Yep. He couldn't hide it anymore.
Everyone kind of knew it, but at the same time, it the reason why they hit it was because it didn't matter. That wasn't the focus of it.
But it had become a focus over the past years. I mean, everybody
had to confirm it. Yeah. They had to confirm it just to
I didn't know until this month, to be honest, the way they played it off this whole time.
Yeah. I think most people probably didn't, Gio, but like a lot of us have been doing some like investigative stuff in the background, and even Clifford like a couple of weeks ago showed a picture of Sandy and her kid on IMDb. It was actually her kid's IMDb page. and
whose last name is Roberts.
Yeah, whose last name is Roberts, and Sandy was in the pitcher, like the fifth pitcher over.
Mm-hmm. Oh, see, I didn't even see that. I wasn't even new. I see. People always make it seem like it matters, like a couple can't work together. I don't understand. They're always real professional. My parents own a business together, and they run together just fine. And people was like, "Oh yeah, you can't have family run a business together." That's bullshit. Yeah,
well, yeah. It's the reason why people were bringing it up. People were bringing this stuff up before, like the whole like, well, she only got the job because she was his wife and all this kind of stuff. And it's like, yeah, well, she has experience. She has training in this field because she went to school for it. She's also a model, mm-hmm. but you know, she has experience. And when they started out, people forget how small the team was. It was eight people.
Yeah,
like eight people in a room. You know, and some Crytek guys who volunteered to help out or were like brought over from Crytek to help build it a little bit, the first demos. And so when you have that small of people, you need to pick people out who are going to be cheap. And your wife is going to be pretty fucking cheap if you're
right. Well, let's rephrase that. She won't cost very much.
There you
go. That's what I know.
If my wife is sometimes on my streams a few times, and you know, if my wife is able to stream when I'm say busy, I've got stuff I could do at work or something like that, and she mm-hmm. can step in and do it, she's going to do it for me because you know she's my wife and she knows that I'm passionate about streaming.
Yeah.
So and that's the similar thing. It's like she stepped up to the plate because her husband wanted her to help. She had the experience and she wanted to make the mixed reality. That's that simple. It's that yep. simple.
Beautiful. Yep. She wanted to help her husband realize his dream. That's what family's for.
Yeah. You know, she was telling a story one time. I think it was on Nikki Batgirl's page. She did an interview with her, and she was telling a story about how Chris was asking her for some input, like, man, should I keep funding or should we use this money and then keep a publisher? And she was like, no, keep going. Let's pay that publisher or that private or whoever the hell it was. Pay them off, and let's just go full-on crowdfunding. And she gave him that extra push. You know, men need that extra push from their wife and that help and that advice. Yeah, so I was thinking about that. Then I'm like, man, he was real close with Sandy at that time to listen to her and trusted her. So I guess when that confirmed, it wasn't really too much of a surprise, but they have been hiding it pretty well.
Like I say, anyone who's married knows that, you know, the person who you're married to, you're going to put a lot of trust in, and they often come at you with very honest answers that are often things that you have absolutely no – they have absolutely no interest in. But they support mm-hmm. you, but they're going to give you an honest answer if something's right or wrong.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Absolutely.
Well, so. What people tend to forget is both Sandy and Chris, even Sandy alone, is worth a couple multi-million dollars. They are really well off. They don't need the backer money to go on trips or, you know, they've already, a lot of these pictures that she's always tweeted or put on her Facebook is past people that they've already known within the movie industry. They've already gone to these lavish races and stuff before on their own money, because that's why she keeps her name Sandy Gardner, because she has contracts with the modeling deals. It's a brand, just like Chris Roberts is a brand. She's not going to change that because that's world peace.
I will correct you. Chris Roberts is the George Lucas of Space Sims.
Oh my God!
According to Gary fucking Oldman. So.
Of all people, Gary Oldman said that.
Yeah. Hey. Yeah.
Confirmed.
Confirmed.
Chris Roberts is the George Lucas of Space Sims. Confirmed. Gary Oldman said so. Good point.
Yeah.
He's not a brand. He's George Lucas.
So. So I guess we can start talking about some of the stuff they started showing tonight.
Mm-hmm. Oh, first of all, I love the timeline video. That needed
We're watching
be
it right now.
Shown.
Yeah.
Yes, loved every bit of that because it breaks down what happened. Some of the office that just got put up in 2013, because everyone keeps yelling, 3 years, 3 years. But it just, we didn't have 200-something, you know, employees working at that time when we first started. It grew over time, and people keep saying, oh, yeah, you guys had 3 years, and this is all you have. They have gotten quite a far ways if you look at what they started from on this timeline. I think they did a hell of a job so far, and we're going to have Squadron 42 by 2016, I think. I think the end of 2016, we'll have Squadron 42.
Oh, yeah. Not anything by the end. I think we'll probably get around June. That's what I'm hoping.
And also, if you look at right now, before the last Reverse the Verse, Sandy was going over there to the new studios that they're moving into, which is a giant warehouse slash studio. It was originally, since it already had a pre-set up studio there, they'll have plenty more room to do mocap shoots there, do their Around the Verse and do other media stuff that they want. Even if they wanted to do another next great Starship, they can do it on less of a dime. They don't have to go to the YouTube pavilion and do that, et cetera. So they can, you know, present the quality that they're going for a lot easier. And then also, it's just on top of that, they've come a long way. And, you know, from his humble beginnings of just being him and a couple of guys working, and of course, the other guy working, is it Sean Tracy from CryEngine? That was his, you know, basically his go-to guy for the CryEngine until he decided to leave CryEngine and go work for him to do the first demo. And then it ballooned out from there. And, you know, Chris wouldn't have gone down this road. He wouldn't have gone down if it wasn't because the backers willed him to do so. Everybody said, do it. We want it. And, yep. You know, and now, you know, you have a few, the smaller voices trying to backpedal this, saying that, well, you're taking too long. You're blowing it too much. No, the majority of the backers wanted it that way. They didn't want him to hold it back like a regular publisher would.
That's right.
That was the whole point of this thing. I don't understand. If you want a rushed game, they have plenty of games that come out every year that you could go buy season passes for and play every year. Go do that.
There's Assassin's Creed. Go play Assassin's Creed. One comes out every year.
I think that's going to be kind of an issue eventually, is that this game I don't think is as digestible as a lot of the other games we play. Like when you play the game I just mentioned earlier, Until Dawn, that has like a one or two or maybe three time playthrough, about 9 hours a pop. So let's just say 18, 36 hours at the maybe 36 hours out of that game. This one I'm expecting to play for years. You know, years, even Chris definitely. Roberts at the end said that Wing Commander still stands on his feet even though it's this many years on. So
it's just a good game.
He's trying to build a game that's gonna have legs and stand for a long time. So you know, I'm not all that worried about that.
Well, and I think the year next year will go by pretty quickly, because if they do by the end of this year do the big drop that they're going to do where everything's merged together, just from what they identified that's in that large world map, and then it's easier for them to add things into it. There's going to be so much to you actually be able to play with your friends. So there's so much play quality, playability to that portion of the game. So when that drops and people are able to make their own fun in this new content map, they're not even, you know, months are going to go by quickly.
You said the key word right there. Let's start talking about that. You said the key word, map.
Yeah.
Oh, the new star large board map.
Let me see if I can find it on the video. You guys go ahead and talk about it. I'm going to see if I can find it here on the video.
Okay. One of the best things.
I'm going to say I've played around with it during the stream. Like I had the stream in the background. I pulled it up when they released it.
Mm-hmm.
That is probably one of the most immersive maps I have ever seen.
Well, and comparatively dangerous.
A lot of my viewers compared it to like the Mass Effect maps. If you're playing Mass Effect, when you go into the systems, you see the individual planets, you see their moons, you see the like asteroids, you see points of interest, you can, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And then Elite Dangerous, you know, it's the size of an Elite Dangerous map with the detail of a
the detail in this is absolutely gorgeous.
Compared to Elite Dangerous, I mean, which is just basically a picture and some lines. I mean, it's ridiculous. Triple A level detail in terms of like the all of the stuff that goes involved with it.
And the quality, because of, you know, not being as, you know, some of these planets, like they said, are going to be procedurally generated because it'll just help, you know, with the flow. But just the handcrafted quality of each of these systems is going to be mind blowing. And I love it that they decide to, you know, and a lot of people are going to give them flack saying, well, y'all changed the business model again, because, you know, they said now we're going to take this test bed and we're going to build out from there and build the universe on out from there, which I'm all for that change. That's a good change. And I think that's an Aaron Roberts change.
It's development.
We just hit 91 million. They made $1 million since the start of the show.
Since the show, since the start of what we just did now, they made $1 million.
Well, not this show, the CitizenCon show.
Since CitizenCon. So, CitizenCon started 3 hours ago.
Yep.
So,
well, if I had my bonus, I would have bought that 2,500 pack.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Stupid Ford.
They're lucky. Ford, if Ford wasn't acting up and we had, don't have to go on strike, I sure would have had that package.
No, but in terms of like development, that's standard early access development procedure. You build the base model and you build work off the base. Every early access game, successful early access game, Ark Survival Evolved, DayZ, even Elite did that. So
or a bot for Twitch. Because we just went on beta on Monday, and exactly that. We have a base model, and now we're adding to it because you can't shove all of it at once and release it, right? You don't know what you need. And, you don't even know what you don't need, you know.
And then plus, Domo, you're getting a lot more feedback to tailor that business model to the more broader audience. So then you'll know exactly, hey, these are some things we never even thought about before, and they're great ideas. Mm-hmm. And it becomes really organic when they release, like Chris, as I know, is biting his teeth and nails, can't wait to get this to us because he can't wait to see what we do with it.
Yeah.
And what kind of neat things that we can come up with.
Right.
And we're gamers. There will be weird stuff, cool stuff, crazy stuff. There'll probably be an entire genre of something coming out of Star Citizen.
Mm-hmm.
Just as much as like Battle Royale came out of DayZ or H1Z1 or any of those kind of things. There'll be some sort of thing that comes out of it just because of how creative we are.
Now, that's a game that hasn't made that much progress as DayZ. Now, people never talk about that. And we've seen all this progress with this game and everyone still bashes.
People have jumped off of DayZ by now. I mean, they can't put up with it anymore.
I'm pissed with it because I bought that game. I used to watch the mod videos. I was like, oh, shit, I'm going to support them and get this shit done. Yeah. I mean, I haven't seen shit get done in that game. Yeah. And no one says a word.
Hell, take on Mars, which I know Domo is sore subject for Domo. But
I love that game.
Take on Mars, which is made by the same company and has a smaller development team, has almost reached their beta status faster than DayZ, and it came out before DayZ.
Yeah, yeah.
That's a damn shame.
Hey, so, you know, it's just ridiculous. It's like it's been around for only maybe a month or so longer than DayZ has. And
I'm wearing it because somebody from Test asked me to wear it because of Captain Richard, so I'm going to wear it for a little bit.
I don't mind wear the hat, but you're wearing it over the top of your headphones.
It's working fine.
Well, whatever.
I will go on record. I'm going to go on record and say I was there when he bought that. I was standing right next to Captain Richard when he bought that hat.
There was a moment in time.
I touched it. So you have some Paul Shelley DNA on there, Clifford.
Oh yeah, yeah. Got some of the beer DNA on it all over. Yeah.
Is anyone going to mention that the whole show took place underneath the Cutlass?
No, it wasn't a Cutlass. It was a
Concord, what do you mean?
It was a Concord.
It was a Genesis.
I get that, but did y'all not get the whole Cutlass vibe from that?
When I saw that thing start up, I'm like, did they fucking pay for a set that looks that real? I was flipping out because I was in a meeting. Like I said, I missed the first 15 minutes, so I was in a meeting and I came back and I'm like, what the hell? They got a real ship up over the top of it. That's money because it looks so real.
I thought it was a model of a Cutlass. I thought they had a prop built of a Cutlass, and I was looking for a small Concord in the background. I didn't realize they're going to have the fucking show under a real Concord.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's crazy.
The airport, I think, actually rents out that that hangar to do conventions and stuff like that in presentations.
Which is awesome.
That whole thing. So that's
what a great
cool.
place.
It was awesome.
VapidCast. Yeah. Yes, we were.
I really wish I would have went to that. It looked like it would have been so much fun. I see everyone that's there from my org there, and it's
And it was such a quality presentation, too. That was well thought out. The stream went perfect. The audio was great.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was perfect. A couple missed clicks. Other than that, they have not had a stream that beautiful
ever.
Yet.
Ever.
Perfect.
I was going to say that. Yeah, I haven't seen one run this smooth.
The reason why they paid for those. They hired those two guys who do video stuff for them. It's the reason why they hired them.
I'm glad they did because, honestly, all the streamers that I know of that have been following Star Citizen forever have been trying to help them out. Like, you know, remember in the beginning?
We'll show up and we'll do it first. Just pay us like.
Wasn't that the first stream that they did was on YouTube or something, and it crashed horribly? And they're like, "Well, we're never doing that again." We're like, "Everyone's like, go to Twitch."
It had a copyright strike.
Oh, did it?
They had, because they started singing "Happy Birthday" to what's her name?
My bad.
It's all right.
I'm forgetting her name. She was in customer service for a while. Her husband, Chelsea. It was Chelsea's birthday, so they started singing "Happy Birthday" to Chelsea. And YouTube automatically does the text and takes it down because it's copyrighted by Warner Brothers.
Which is so. I just love Twitch so much better for that because Twitch Twitch mutes it after the fact. You put your VOD up and it's muted, and it's like, okay, so I played a song I wasn't supposed to. Mute that part. YouTube, fucking death. Turn it off.
Thank God. The birthday song is not copyrighted.
Not anymore. Yeah,
thank God.
They've proven that that's like a complete.
But Chris
bullshit.
Roberts should be banned from singing "Happy Birthday" for the
rest
of
his guy's tone deaf. He's a bit tone deaf.
Oh, Adrian.
Okay, you know, when I was watching this demonstration up there, I really had, I had this feeling that they were going to show a lot of combat, you know, as far as like just the FPS normal level that we saw, because that was a different place that they were shooting at. It looked a little bit different. And then all of a sudden they spring this on us. It's like, hey, this is incorporated into that large world map. And it's just like, it showed how much work they'd done in such a short a time.
That was the most
that
impressive
studio
thing to
is
me.
Amazing.
That's the most impressive thing to me is that all along we've been, I mean, I just want to talk about this as an overall thing. All along, myself, Clifford, Geo, Grayheaded Gamer, and Paul, and Zerker, and all the other people that I know that are content creators for Star Citizen, we have been sort of having this dream of what we think this game is going to be like. And through time, they've been releasing little snippets of that dream, and we can see what's going to happen on the horizon, but other people can't. It's whether we're like drinking the Kool-Aid or what, I don't know, but
or the cult
or the yeah, whatever it is,
the cult
for the cult, whatever the hell it is we're drinking.
Excuse us for wanting us to have an innovating game. Excuse the fuck.
No. But
I know what a cult is. I'm actually part of the cult of the evil unicorn.
A cult.
So I can't,
you're saying
you know.
Cult. Okay. But anyway, what I'm trying to say is no matter what it is that we've been smoking or whatever that has caused us to sort of see what we could possibly see. Today was like the culmination of what we've been seeing, and it came out of nowhere. Like, none of us have seen any kind of screenshots of Gary Oldman or any of that other stuff. We haven't seen any of these things at all. They've been doing such a great job of keeping it behind the scenes at the same time while being open about so much more of the development.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's basically, this is the thing that from now on, when someone's like, Star Citizen, I'm going to be like, this is Star Citizen. Look at this Squadron 42 trailer and tell me if this is not exactly like a Mass Effect or or a Halo or a Call of Duty or an Assassin's
Times
Creed.
Times two.
Yeah, this is the level of detail that you can expect. Oh, here's also the walkthrough, which is not even a finished product, and it still has better like LO level of detail than most AAA games that release today.
Yeah, he said it was really buggy, and then when they played it, I was like, I'd play that game.
Yeah,
there's a little clipping and a little sound problems, but I'd play that. That freaking inside of that interest was beautiful.
That was the level of completion that they pushed Assassin's Creed Unity out with. So why not?
Well, you know, it's like, it was so funny though. I felt myself at moments like imagining myself wearing an Oculus Rift doing this, but also watching it on screen made me hold on to my desk and go like that when they were zooming into the planet and all of a sudden
I thought he was gonna crash.
Appears.
Yeah, he was.
Yeah. You're gonna hit the planet.
I was like, I thought he was. Because they're Elite Dangerous. I'm so used to like, oh shit, overheating.
Yeah.
Let me see if I can find that clip in the part in the video.
But I mean, as it zooms in so quickly, you're just like, and I tell you what, just watching the guy EVA out of his Hornet and go through into the station that is actually a working station into
the
exhaust port.
Yeah, I was scared. I was scared.
I was waiting for Xenomorphs.
It felt so dead space, dude.
Yeah.
The ambient, the atmosphere effects and all, it made that borderline spooky.
Mm-hmm. I will level one criticism at this, and I think it's just because it's a work in progress, is that it seems like all of the landing pads for all of these stations are exposed to vacuum. So how are you supposed to wear your sweet ass duster and your
right.
your clothes and walk into a station like a boss when you have to walk into vacuum? You're gonna have to put a full suit on to be able to leave your ship.
I know
eventually they'll fix it so that like there'll be like that hangar in the FPS trailer they did where Redeemer flies into the hangar with the little
they'll have those, but then they'll have these, and then they'll also have planet side where you'll be able to just once ride out. So I mean, I know a lot of these stations is pretty much this is their first iteration to where you can just, you know, spawn in your ship and go fly off, and these stations will probably be more so found in maybe military space or basically far off planet side, you know, where, you know, no planets are close by. This is the closest place you can go to. I can see more of these stations being like, you know, there, and you have to walk out in a suit, you know, suit up and walk across, because it's just there for you to refuel, get any quick repairs that you need to get done, and move on down the merry way, you know?
You know what? Another thing is the repair bots, I want them to do more than just scan across.
Yeah,
they said they're going to add more to it, though, didn't he?
Yeah, because that seemed a bit weird. I would rather a little bot had come out with, like, some, like, mech kind of thing had come out to the platform and kind of, like, was, like, zooming or, you know, like on the ship or something, you know, something like that.
Yeah, because that would be cool to, like, diagnose it and then, you know, have it actually repaired afterwards after it does all the scans.
Yeah,
well, I'm sure that was all work in progress. I mean, but the fact
that he said that
we saw was very basic.
Okay.
Now, the one thing I do want to have is I want to have a mod where you can replace the chassis of these little hover bots with bears, so that we can have fucking repair bears.
What about that little mech that came out? Was like a full like mech from Mech Warrior kind of thing, but it had a bear suit on it.
Like an astromech or something.
Yeah,
like
a bear, but it has a bear suit on it. Like a
yeah.
It's like strapped down with zip ties or something.
Like Five Nights at Freddy's.
Yes.
There you go. But you know what, Gio? It would be nice if they come out, the same ones they have now, like you say, scan the ship, and then the repair bots come out with their welding tips and their body hammers and stuff like that.
Or even like NPCs, like EVA out and like the cheaper places.
Now,
Lethality has a good point. They say they should also have this, which is something they were talking about with the whole economy system of the game, is they should be able to say, hey, we don't have those parts right now. We can repair your wing, but we don't have these parts, and then that puts a call out for me, Space Trucker, to go pick up a load from somewhere and drop it off at that station. Make a mission out of it, yeah.
Yes. Who said that?
A Lethality, MMO, in the chat.
Good job, Lethality.
Yeah, and I do love the idea where you go on a station and battle it out, and somebody can gank your ship and go.
Yeah, right? You're sitting there, you just get back, you're all blown up, and you're like, oh, God, I'm going to go and get a beer. And you get off the ship, and then like they gank you and take your shit.
Yes.
My chat, when we were watching it, I had the chat up and was just watching it, and my chat was saying, like, I am now going to lock my ship wherever I go because some idiot's going to walk out and just steal that shit if I don't.
And it's good, and I don't think they expected the pirates to kill the Marines so fast. He's like, oh, y'all just wiped them out, and they just jumped in the ship and hauled ass. Beautiful.
Well, what do you
expect? It shows it's a game. It's not a demo. It's not a video. They were playing that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I'm fucking hyped.
They even said that it happens. It depends on what happens and who gets where and when. You know, it happens.
Now, if your ship gets stolen, will your insurance pay for it? I suppose. We talked about this a long, long time ago, back in the earlier StarCast, a long time ago, was fraud, like insurance fraud. You know, how's that? How do you guys think that'll play out?
They've talked about how easy it is going to be to detect him, because they've said about how every single ship and every part of a ship is an individual entity that has its own markings in the game. They've already talked about that. So it's not that difficult to figure out if your ship is stolen and the GM only has to say, okay, well, where is the ship being taken? You know, this person's lost like four ships in the last 2 days. Mm-hmm. Let's see who has these ships. Okay, so the Dread Pirate Roberts has this.
WTF has
one of these.
Right.
And then the other two are by this dude named, you know, Ducks R Us.
Right.
And you go, okay, why does he have two of his ships? That's weird. And then you could look up into the ship and find out, look into the code, or not code, but just look at the players and find out that Ducks R Us is a friend of the main guy. And you go, okay, that's funky. And you just stop immediately. And you can even code that into the game itself could probably register and be like, okay, well, you're not going to be able to do this because – you know, register a ship lost if your friend has the ship, mm-hmm. if we know that your friend has a ship. And then they can do lore like, you know, oh, well, you've had this many claims. We have to stop and investigate before we can give you a new one and those sorts of things.
Then it'll take longer for your ship every time it gets stolen and shit. It's going to take longer and longer for you to get another ship.
Let me – a little niggle. I just want to – real quick, I'm watching this video here. They were lined up outside of the satellite, right? Mm-hmm. At that point, it's venting off of the port side near the cockpit. Yep. There's a part right here where they're about ready to hit Jupiter. I'm like, no, they're going to hit it. when they're stopped there, it seems to me, this is just, if they're venting like that, it should be pushing the nose of the ship around. Like, it should be...
Unless the thrusters are correcting
for it. The thrusters could be correcting, but I'd want to see the right side. I'd like to see the starboard side thrusters pushing off against it, because that would be ultra-realism right there. If they had that kind of stuff...
There's also a level of realism that I'm willing to fudge for a game like this.
For fun.
True.
Because it would be fun, you know, just like fight it all the time because then, like, you get any damage whatsoever to your ship, and anything gets vented, all of a sudden, everything is screwed up. And
Scott then Manley was just playing a game the other day. I was watching. I forget what his Rogue is. It Rogue Galaxy or something?
Was it the DCS in space one?
Yeah. I don't know about ETS. It was. It looks like Kerbal Space Program from first person view. It was ultra. Like he had his flips like 50 buttons just to get the thing to turn on. He had to do the right.
Oh yeah, yeah. No, it's DCS in space. That's why I call it DCS in space because I don't remember what DCS is, but it's that flight simulator where you have like actual buttons and switches and everything matters.
Yeah,
it's basically like that. Yeah,
you have to turn it on the right correct sequence. And I was gonna play it.
You get like the generators revved up and warmed up and all that kind of stuff.
And you got to turn on your heater if your heater's on.
That's
before.
Too much.
Yeah, it's way too much. And I was thinking, I'm glad Star Citizen's not going down that far the sim path. I do want a little bit of arcadey feel to this, you know.
Yeah. But that Connie was definitely been majorly beefed up and overhauled
it's
from
cool.
the looks of it. And a lot of people loved seeing the turrets actually out.
Mm-hmm. That Connie was very, very maneuverable. And I'm thinking they beefed up the maneuverability for the demo just because it would make it faster and easier to get around where it is going to be. But it felt very like at one point he just pulls out of like a station and just does like a quick like 90-degree turn. And it's like less than a second. He just flips it like right around. It's like, whoa.
Wait a minute. Now, while we're on the Connie, mm-hmm. what did you guys think about that explosion on ATV? I know
we talked about that.
I was waiting for that in this demo. I was like, I want to see a large fucking explosion live.
That, there were pants that had to be changed after the explosion. I'm just going to be very honest. And I have a lot of
it
nice
was so
pants,
glorious.
And I don't have so
the-
many anymore.
The interior view of that was actually borderline frightful. That the sound effects, the creaking, the comms telling you, like, ejections down, watching streaks of electricity fly over your head, you could tell where lasers are hitting and stuff.
Yeah,
that
like
was fucking scary.
Like, honestly, there should be a warning on that. Like, if you have PTSD, if you've served in the military and experienced, like, shit exploding around you, you might trigger you kind of thing. That shit's that realistic about
I'm glad
how,
you brought that up, Gio. That's that explosion. Yeah. I've never seen an explosion like that.
Mayhem.
When they actually showed it where you could see the cockpit exploding and the oxygen venting out of the exploding cockpit and all the glass shards flying.
The atmosphere, yeah.
Get out of here, man.
But I can only imagine like in a submarine, like it gave you that feeling in Retaliator, like a submarine like blowing up inside and you're just like, oh shit, where'd I go?
Yeah.
Omnidon didn't brings up a good point, is that it was pre-visualized, which means it's not actually coded into the game yet. But I will argue the fact
that... But it was in engine.
That Battlefield, the new Battlefield that's coming out this year, the beta that you can play right now, has almost that level of explosion. Battlefront, I'm sorry, Battlefront.
Yeah, I get mixed up too.
Whatever.
All the time.
It's basically
whatever.
Battlefield.
It's Battlefield.
Yeah. In space, yeah.
Battlefield Star Wars.
Yeah, Battlefield
I'll give you that.
Yeah, but its level of detail in terms of the explosions and those kind of things are almost the level that we saw in that pre-visualization. So it's completely possible that that's the final visualization that we'll see. It's just not procedural yet.
But
it's coming.
It is in game. So
yeah, it's in game. It just pre-visualized. It's not quite in.
It's actually an in-engine effect. So all they have to do, like I said, is code it in. So it's 100% possible.
Yeah, because the reason why they said they haven't done it yet is they're still trying to find out, okay, what pieces are going to break apart when these certain explosions have. They still got to work out what pieces are going to break away when it explodes in certain areas of the ship.
And that's important as well because of salvage. Because they have to figure out how are they going to register these salvage parts, because all of these parts have to be salvageable by another player or an NPC, which they all have to have their own values and that kind of stuff, which will, you know, of course, be generated a bit depending on the economy. But those parts, every part of the game has a part of the game that it has to affect. So everything is linked together. So you can't just kind of create an explosion without having the consequences of an explosion, which is either death.
Let me pull back to the presentation. I do want to talk a little bit before we move on too far. Is I want to talk about the new HOTAS.
Okay.
What did you get? You're cut off, Gray. Couldn't hear you.
It's actually a really, you know, they addressed one of my main issues, which was the very narrow bottom, and mm-hmm. it looked very fragile, and they addressed that specific.
We like people with a big bottom, and it means they're stable. Yes.
Right on.
I don't know. You got the price point. What do you guys think it's going to be? There's going to be two different models with two different attachment sets, so you can.
I thought they said that one was going to be $150. I thought.
Is that what they said? Where
did yeah, they said around. Yeah, they said around.
Said around 150.
Okay. Yeah, but the more higher end model, that one's going to be about 300 and up. I can tell you that right
it's
now.
It said 400. I'm guessing 450. Yeah,
I'm thinking higher, five or so.
Well, I think one reason that gives it away to me that it's going to be much higher, the high end one, is because Chris finally mentioned OLED display. Mm-hmm. OLED is expensive.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But it's touch. It's a touch screen. Remember that they said it was, and they said it wasn't, but then they verified again it was. So it is. It's gonna be a touch screen OLED. Think about that as far as configurability, because let's just go outside of Star Citizen. If you're playing a different game, Elite Dangerous, you could
like that Rogue system. Then all of a sudden you've got buttons you can hit on your toggle.
Talk about immersion, man. I mean, that's just kick ass. And,
I'll pay top dollar for it. I just hope SciTech or MadCat. You know, MadCat makes cheap fucking controllers. I just hope they get it right. They could really win over the community if they make a good stick for us.
SciTech makes good controllers.
I was going to say, people forget that SciTech made, they used to, and then MadCats bought them. But here's the problem, is that MadCats bought them and their quality dropped because of the transition, and then their quality went back up.
True.
People forget that MadCat SciTech built the fighting sticks, the fight sticks combos.
X65?
I have the X55, the X...
No, not the flight sticks, the fightings, the for Street Fighter and...
Oh, you're talking about the old console, the old arcade games.
Yeah, no, they built modern ones for competitions.
Yeah, I mean, they do good stuff. I mean, they also have a whole thing for Farm Sim. They've got, this whole module that you can drive your tractor with. It looks just like a real John Deere interior. And
to the point, they even pointed this out, is that CIG employees have pointed out, is that it is the standard model that MadCats makes. It's the standard model for all the competition level because it doesn't break. Because it's got very good quality. And I think the problem is that MadCats has got this reputation from early on. It was the cheap alternative to first level.
Years and years and years ago when I was building PCs, back in the 80s, I know it dates myself here, but Logitech was the worst possible pieces of shit you could ever own, okay? And now they're really looked upon as being a good quality product. Now, maybe not the joysticks. Their 3D Pro thing is a crap.
But that's because they haven't made it in years.
Right,
it's the thing that they.
But their
they
keyboards are good quality keyboards. Their mice are good quality mice. But years ago, you wouldn't even want to touch a Logitech project. So maybe MadCats can kind of come back around, and maybe this will be a good thing. Like Gio was saying, it might be enough to pull people back into the MadCats field.
Now, how do you guys feel about the referral program? I was going to say this because
I don't want to leave the controllers. One other issue I have with the controller that I'm curious. The trackballs on it.
Love it. Love the idea.
Yeah, well, I want to. It's going to all depend on how well they actually really work and how pinpointed
they are.
They are
way more precise than a normal mouse. And I've got a gaming mouse, which is like 8,500 DPI or something like that. They could easily get that kind of DPI out of a trackball.
Okay. I'm just kind of curious.
I just hope they listen to the community. Like, if they really take our feedback and listen to the community, I think it's going to work out fine. But if they just do whatever the fuck they want, act like they want to work with us, that's not going to work.
I think they will. All right, go ahead there, Paul. Or is it Berserker?
You say Paul. Paul Berserker. He's the one who works.
I'm sorry.
but because everyone, I do say it on my stream all the time. But the referral program. How do you guys think about it? I personally am glad that they're doing it, but it seems a little odd because most other referral programs is monetary compensation for the referrer. Like you get a percentage of it or something like this. In this case, it's in-game stuff. Including ships, if I remember correctly. Like, you actually can get ships for referring a number. Like, if you refer 15 people, you get a Gladius.
They also give you UEC, which is also, you would actually buy that with real money, to get UEC. Yeah. So they're kind of in a way giving you money back, basically.
Yeah, real quick.
I can't spend it anywhere but Star Citizen. You know, that's the thing. Like, if I want to buy my... use it to support my stream so I can get more, better heart equipment. I can't do that. I can only spend it on Star Citizen.
Well, yeah, but if they were paying, people to promote the game, then that would be even more bad press. Oh, yeah, they're paying people to promote a scam that's not even out. I can see stupid shit now. So
the referral systems are pretty common. Like, I'm part of Steel Series affiliate program, the new Steel Series affiliate program, and they give me certain things for referring people to buy their products.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think affiliate systems are great. We're using an affiliate system on BrainBot. So, it's totally fine to use an affiliate system, and whatever you can figure out some kind of way. Because it does, it's instant grassroots promotion,
I love SteelSeries.
Ooh. Me too. But I think it's fine. I don't think they're offering any. I mean, I would actually be kind of creeped out if they were offering money. The only part that I'm kind of sad about is all of us here have been content creators for a very long time, and how many thousands of people have we
I've
got?
I've got at least 200 people who've been referred to. Just because of my.
We're never going to get anything from it, but it's okay. It's from this point on, you know.
It's all for love.
It is for love, really.
Yeah, but for love for the game.
Well, it's no different with like, and I play Final Fantasy 14 with my wife, and they did a promotional program where I referred a friend, and now they're locked to my account. That I get I'll get this special mount that nobody else can get. That I will get later for a certain amount of feathers as long as they keep staying with the gang.
Well, hold on. I have to stop for a second. Callum's calling me out saying that Logitech's always been great. And I said, no, it was really bad in the 80s. He goes, you're not old enough to have been a gamer in the 80s.
Jesus Christ.
Oh, my God. I love you.
I'm probably the youngest person on this crew next to Gio, and I'm in my 30s, near my 30s. Everybody else has been around for... since before computers were a thing.
I started playing Zork on a PC in 1982.
Bro, I played Zork on a TRS-80.
Yeah, it was a good game, right? You see the mailbox? Open the mailbox.
Gray-headed gamer, okay?
Yeah.
I had the old one. Mine was an old ProTech computer. And then even before then, I played at school on a green screen, played Carmen Sandiego and
Oregon Trail, yeah.
Oregon Trail.
You have dysentery. You're dead.
Yeah, I remember Oregon Trail when I was a kid. I love that. Oh my gosh.
We're all old farts,
man.
We
actually used BASIC and programmed an interface to use a modem that you put your phone into the cups and we could text each other back and forth. This is before text messages, and we thought we were freaking scientists back then.
If you had sold that technology, you would have made millions.
Oh, McKitten does bring up a point that both the subreddits of PC gaming and PC Master Race are eating up the presentation from Star Citizen.
Nice.
And it's one of those vindication moments. I think this is our vindication moment for being Star Citizen backers for being early adapters or what do they call them in that bell curve where you have like early adapters,
cultists,
pioneers, or something like that. Pioneers, early adapters, and then moving over.
Well, Domo hit the nail on the head. We've had this vision forever, and now everyone else can see it.
Yeah, right. Everyone else can see what we see.
It's getting there.
Yeah.
We were just dreamers, baby.
I mean, if you're a gamer and you see what we saw, what we just saw, it is one of those things that you can start seeing the progression. Because now, for us, it was a lot of promises and hopes with some little bits and pieces. This was significant content that's in very early stages that we can see.
That I am not at all ashamed to show anyone. To this point, you kind of like, can you see this? Like, can you imagine that on this ship there are going to be four or five guys walking around and they're all going to be like doing the console, the controls? Can you imagine that? And they're like, yeah, I guess, but it's okay. It's kind of, you know, clunky. And I'm like, no, it's going to be great. It's, you know, and so now we're actually like, do you see that, Gary Oldman? Do you see that? And Mark Hamill?
Did you see Gary Oldman and Mark Hamill and fucking Dana Scully and Gollum himself are all going to be in the same goddamn place?
Scully and Gollum.
Operational Idris. I just can't get over it seems like you're on Mass Effect only. This is an actual ship that you could fly yourself. It's not just walk around.
It's not like, the Normandy.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
This is like Mass Effect on steroids. I mean, that's what this is. God. Mass Effect was like a story with some gameplay elements that you could play. And but that's about it. With this game, it's like you just go. It's like here's the world.
Man.
Good luck.
What I like mostly about Star Citizen is, you know, it's the same. It goes back to the same notion that Chris Roberts, when he said that that PC is always the best platform because you could always push technology. And what people I don't think really realize is that when this game is fully fleshed out and they'll continue to add stuff to it, this will set a new bar in the industry that people will try for, and we will actually overall across the board get better games out of all other studios, because they'll be, you know, just like World of Warcraft set the bar for MMOs and had people started taking different features and working upon that, building upon that, and creating better games. This is going to set a new level in gaming, you know, industry. And even like No Man's Sky and the other ones, they're setting different bars in different genres that will just keep increasing the interaction and fidelity of games going forward. So,
absolutely,
you know, this innovation renaissance that we're going to is just going to push new games to a new height.
Not only that, but we also, I think, one of the major things to think about is that Chris Roberts, the reason why this game is funded is because Chris Roberts had a good vision and because he's Chris Roberts. Mm-hmm. He's the George Lucas of space games.
According to Gary Oldman.
Yeah, as per Gary Oldman. This is a direct quote from Gary Oldman. But think about the other people out there, the people who were behind Halo or the original Call of Duty games or the Mass Effect series or Final Fantasy. If they just said, you know what, we don't need publishers anymore. We can make the games we want to do if we go to the fans. And that's huge. That's massive. That's changing the way that things are made. And that's what that Star Citizen's represented. It's like if you get to a certain level, if you have a fan base that's loyal enough, they will go to bat for you. They will help you make a game that you wanted to make, that they want to see. And you don't have to compromise with anybody. You don't have to talk to them. You don't even have to like have them come through your studios. You can have their fans come through the studios, and they'll just sit there going, oh, my God, instead of, this is not our quarterly review. It's not up to date. And you know,
you're not
you don't
making
have to...
money yet.
Man, yeah, exactly. There's no corporate suits telling you what to do. You can just do what you want. And it's what so many of these guys started doing video games for back in the 90s and, you know, in early 2000s. That's what they did. That's why they did it. It's why they wanted to make video games. And now Chris Roberts is helping to move this to that point, move gaming to that point where this can be a big thing, which is, I think, even more shattering to the industry, especially to publishers than anything. Because now publishers have to keep – you have to start –
publishers are probably worried now. Yeah,
I was just about to say that. You know what's scary in this industry is, okay, the game stayed $60, but what people are not noticing is that games really aren't still $60. They're $60, and then you got to pay for a season pass, and then they're taking away.
You talked about in your video this
$60 games.
It's like $100.
You're only paying for multiplayer, like Titanfall multiplayer only, Evolve multiplayer only, Battlefront coming out. Multiplayer only. So you're paying for half a game of Rainbow Six Siege, multiplayer only. No single player. This game has single player and an online component. For $45, you can get in now. And people are bitching about that.
It's two games. Yeah.
$45.
You're getting.
It's not even like one major game. It's two completely separate games set in the same universe. It would be like buying Halo Wars and Halo 5, the next Halo Wars and Halo 5 in the same package on release. They both get them at the same time. That would be that's
$45.
$45, which is laughable at this point because I'm getting a lot of the new games, right? And I just the other day I was doing the Uncharted series, and that's all the three original Uncharted games, which I love. Great games, right? They're just all they did was they bumped it up to 60 FPS and they updated the models and stuff a little bit. It's $60 for that thing, whereas if you were to go buy Uncharted, if you could buy Uncharted like from G2A or something, they'd be like $5 a game probably for the original three. So $45 for a game of this size is a joke. Like, I just don't get it. I don't get why people are having such a hard time with it, but I guess they'll come around.
Not only that, you don't even actually have to spend $45. If you just want the game to come when it comes out, it's $30.
Yeah, $30.
It's half. It's half.
And people are bitching about that. Yeah. I don't understand that. But you would pre-order a game for $60 and mess up the industry. They come with day one DLC, then the games are broken at launch. We're actually testing the game. Yeah, it may be glitchy and buggy now, but at least we're trying it now before launch, so people won't even have to suffer through that shit.
And I know Gio's not a big fan of Elite, but like, but with Elite was a good example. Elite released a game because they had partially because they had to release the game, but after they added a couple patches early on, you know, stuff that they wanted to add on, and they're continuing to add stuff, things like this next major patch for Horizons. They have multi-crew ships, they have planetary landings, they have avatar creation, they have all these cool things that are adding on to it because the fans enabled them to. If it wasn't for the fans, they wouldn't be able to do it. And
I like Elite now, by the way, too. Yeah, I just don't like how they put community with the landing.
I'm giving you some rubbing, that's all.
Okay.
But and it goes back to, like, right recently I've had time to go back and start playing Dragon Age Inquisition again because, you know, I love, you know, BioWare's games. But just like Dragon Age Inquisition, you pay, you know, about around $60 for the initial game, and now they have three downloaded, you know, extra level patches with extra story, extra map, and they're $14 a piece. That's three times $14, $14.99. on top of that original game, you know. So all the industry gaming you know, outlets are going to this business model of saying, you know, we can get more money out of people if we just offer another package content. And it's no different that, you know, we have a choice whether or not we want to buy that extra content or not. And the same with Star Citizen. You can buy that extra ship if you want, or just wait and just play the game as it is and earn it in game. But you know, the only difference is in Star Citizen, you actually have a possibility of earning these ships in the game versus a standalone like Dragon Age Inquisition. There's no way you can earn that extra content. You have to pay for it.
This is the thing with that. With Dragon Age, I got a Game of the Year edition now. See, this is when I even wait for those games, because after they drop all the season pass and all that bullshit, they'll drop a Game of the Year edition for $60. Then you get all that content that was supposed to be in there in the first place. Because some of these games feel half-baked if you don't buy the season pass. And that's how they're getting over, by keeping the game $60 and keeping some content out.
Right.
Oh, Xylo's in the stream. Hey, Xylo. Yeah. I just not noticed it. Sorry.
I don't want to call him out, because I let him lurk sometimes, you know. He's Xylo is Xylo. He's Captain Xylo.
Yep.
There you go. How about that? Sorry, I was looking at something. I was trying to find a ship, but I don't think it's available anymore. I was looking at some space porn.
Space porn.
Okay. And
space porn. Confirmed.
Yeah. I was going to do a giveaway tonight, but I can't seem to find the ship that I was trying to do the giveaway for.
I'm just going to say this right now. I'm actually kind of excited for 1.3, only because I want to see the clothing store. I want to see what they have in the clothing store.
And the buggies you can drive around.
And the buggies.
Oh, my God. Yes.
I'm going to do some Mario Kart shit on Planet Side. Yeah. I can tell that right now. I'm running people over Grand Theft Auto style,
just
baby.
Just give us access to weapons on Art Corp, and we will have, like, driving buggy wars.
Yes.
That's going to be so awesome.
Lean out the side and shoot at people.
Oh, get the pistol out. Like,
yeah.
That'd be so awesome.
All right.
I'm trying to think of what else that they that really stood out is God, if I could think of it, other than, you know, just seeing the new the actual close-up of the helmets, of seeing the new style. Because you saw that they had the new, totally new suits for the pirates versus the Marines. They were highly detailed. They were awesome and very menacing looking, almost looked like Darth Vader-esque, like, you know. Somebody powerful you don't want to mess with out in the verse.
All right, here's what I'm going to do. Here's what I'm going to do real quick. We're going to do it. We just crossed our threshold for our first hour. We're not going to do an aftercast. We're just going to keep going. So for the next hour, I'm going to give away a Merlin every 20 minutes.
Oh, Merlin hype.
Merlin hype. So I'm going to give away a Merlin every 20 minutes, and that hopefully you guys like Merlins.
Yeah, and
so
don't forget to ask questions. Merlins are
beautiful, you know, man.
They're
Merlins,
great ship.
You can cross-trust the upgrades Merlins for free to an Aurora ES.
Well, there you go.
Yeah, that's another thing I would like to talk about. I'm so glad to see now a lot of, you know, CCU options now. They got so much there to go through. Now you can go back and forth if you want to. It's going to cost you a little bit, but it's just an easier system. It's still kind of wonky. They got to work on it, because you have to click on what you want to CC2 and then click your other ship to get it to work right. Because if you pick your ship first and then pick what you want to CC2, it doesn't work at times.
Yeah.
So
off and on.
I had a couple people last night in the stream tell me that they were having trouble trying to get the CCU to work. Also, Dumbo, I will throw in a We Got Your Back skin for every hour. So we'll have two We Got Your Back
skins. So we're going to give away a Merlin and a We Got a Back skin. We Got Your
Every
Back.
Hour, yeah.
Thank you.
All right. No problem.
And then Trindane would be like, backside.
Back skin.
Back skin.
More back skin.
More back skins.
All right. Thank you so much for that. And then here we go. All right, everybody. Good luck.
You know, one question that I would like to, since Xylo is in the audience, is
who's this Xylo guy? He's going to be kissing his butt.
Who?
Xylo. He's part of.
He's the head QA, I think, for
CIG.
Santa Monica office.
CIG. They make Call of Duty, right?
No, Austin. He's in Austin.
They make Call of Duty, right?
Yes.
He's a Call of Duty QA guy.
But Xylo,
I think so.
What I wanted to ask Xylo was,
I'm
man,
kidding. I'm joking.
How vindicated do you feel right now? Because I know you've known a lot of this stuff has been happening. Maybe you did. Maybe you did. But how? How puffy is your chest right now and proud of your team do you feel at this point in moment? And I'll give you a second for it to catch up.
And tell Tony Z he's fucking awesome, and we would love to interview him.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we'd love to have Tony Z on the show.
I worked out my differences with Ben. He called the judge. He got the restraining order turned off and stuff. So
nice.
He said, yeah, he'll come back. We're going to have him back on the show in a couple of weeks probably.
Okay. Wait, did I miss something?
There is an issue with the bot. Yeah, I just noticed that it doesn't seem to be taking anybody's entries.
Is something? Oh, no. Ben just hasn't been on the show for a while.
Damn.
Yeah.
We want to see him here. But I was going to say, we could probably talk to some of the other guys from CIG as well, because there's plenty of people in, like, the UK and in Frankfurt, I'm sure, who'd want to hang out. Because I've had a couple of them hang out, some QA guys and some customer service guys. And
All right, give me a second, guys. We're going to stop this and start it over again. I'm sorry. We'll get it started. Okay. I think I put the keyword in wrong, because it's not taking anybody's entry.
Stringman.
Oh, you broke it.
We broke the Stringman.
Well, while we're waiting for Dumbo to sort it out, though, what do you think, Berserker, about the saber? What do you think about that military style that they went with?
The ninja hornet is what they're calling it, the ninja hornet. I think it's going to be interesting. It's going to be an Aegis ship with a hornet toughness, which I think
is really... What it represents to me is the new, you know, U.S. military F-22 fighter, like the badass fighter that we got.
It's working. That thing is also freaking broken beyond belief. The F-22 Raptor is so broken. So, yes, I agree. It could be. Yeah. I think it's a good it's a good analogy. It's one of the things that I'm excited about is that they're adding these more of these military ships, so that it's more than just the Hornet or the Gladius, you know, so there's a little bit more variety into it, which makes sense, because if you look at the world around us, we have so many different aircraft manufacturers who make so many different combat airplanes, which are all very equal in terms of what they do, but they have little things they do better than the other ones because they focus on that rather than the other, and which is great because it makes it for a more enriching experience. The only thing I hope, and I know CIG is doing it because it's the only reason why I bring it up, is to bring out more civilian ships. We need more than just the hulls and the freelancers. We need maybe one or two other ships that are, you know, maybe of alien design or of hybrid design that would also haul things a little bit better. We need a little bit more, you know, more than just
more reliance type ships. You know, yeah. More
like for instance, I heard this on Board Gamer and WTF and Twerk. We're talking about this on Redacted, but we need more ships that are smaller, that instead of just like every time you go into a mining field, you're just gonna see a ton of Orions. Like it should be, there should be smaller versions of these different ships that we can use and hang out with, because the civilian ships would be the ones we're gonna interact with all the time in the MMO.
Yeah,
because
yeah,
I'd rather not see just military ships everywhere, because it makes sense.
They confirmed that they were coming though.
Yeah, that's what I said.
It's I know that they're working on them, and it's going to happen. It's just a matter of a matter of time.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people are going to really love this large world map because of how they were talking about how there's going to be different scenarios for, you know, hauling and stuff like that, where people will start, you know, people who maybe have set the Aurora to the side because it's not really applicable will now look at the Aurora in a different way, because now that you got these missions you can utilize and it can carry more cargo and actually have stuff added to it, will add a little bit more value to these other ships too when this larger map drops. You know, then we'll probably start seeing more different types of versatility. And, you know, I can also see, like, you know, you logging in with, you know, your friends and saying, okay, I'm going to bring in my Aurora. I'm going to get some cargo. I'm going to be in a section of space. You got to find me and try and stop me from meeting my goal of, you know, you got to rob me. Basically, you play like you're going to get robbed, but you said you're going to have to try and attack my ship, deactivate it, and try and steal my stuff. And you can make all these different kinds of in-game deals, you know, without, you know, and that's what I think Chris is really referring to as far as wanting to see what people come up with and unique styles of gameplay.
And there are a lot of missions they're putting out too. Do you see when they backed the screen up after the pirates stole the ship and all those destinations?
All those
popped
destinations.
Up,
oh. I was like, yes, look at all that stuff. It's awesome.
Glorious.
I just have a question real quick before we. Is anybody in the audience not seen? Has anybody in the audience not seen the Senate speech, Squadron 42 Senate speech? Because what I was thinking is we could take a quick, quick 5 minute break. And how long is the video? Yeah, it's about 4 minutes. Take a quick 4 minute break. And I'll go ahead and play it for everybody, and then we can come back and continue on with our discussion. How's that sound?
Sounds good.
Sounds good.
Because there's some we have a lot more people here now than when we first started, so it might be good to,
yeah,
to play
and
it again.
And plus, we can lead into maybe asking some people questions too, or answer some questions.
We can do Q&A when we come back. All right, guys. So I'm gonna pop this up. You guys, you can go ahead. I'm gonna mute you, and you can go take a quick 4 minutes and go smoke them if you got them, Ryder, and I'll be right back. You watched it 50 more times. Yeah, me too. Right?
Yay.